Welcome back to Physics Through Computational Thinking. Today we'll talk about periodic motion and dynamics. We'll review oscillatory motion and periodic motion, some of which you are already familiar with. So this is going to be a quick review about the same, and we will slowly build up onto anharmonic oscillators. Let's get started. Let's go ahead and look at another example. This time an example of a pendulum, a simple pendulum. As you're all familiar with the simple pendulum, the equation of motion is given by ml square theta dot equal to minus mgl sine theta, where minus mgl sine theta is the torque, that is the gravity is applying on this bob, and ml square theta dot, ml square is the moment of inertia, and theta double dot is acceleration, angular acceleration. So I times theta double dot is equal to the torque, and from that we get theta double dot equal to minus g by l sine theta. Now that is not an equation of a simple harmonic oscillator. So simple pendulum is not actually a simple harmonic oscillator. However, if you were to take the small angle limit, that is small theta, we immediately say that sine theta will reduce down to theta, and I'll get an equation that is given by this line, and I immediately see that this is the equation of simple harmonic oscillator with g by l being equal to omega square. So from here I see omega square equal to g by l, and therefore omega is equal to square root g by l, the famous result that gives you frequency or time period for the simple pendulum. Now let's examine this problem from the perspective of a potential. For a potential, v of theta is mgl 1 minus cosine theta, because the potential here we can consider as 0. As the pendulum goes up by angle theta, the height that the pendulum gains is L1 minus cosine theta, and therefore the potential becomes mgl 1 minus cosine theta. And if you remember, we plotted this in one of the previous videos. When we plotted this, we found that for small theta it behaved like a quadratic potential, and for small theta you can write cosine theta as 1 minus theta square by 2, and you see that v of theta is mgl by 2 theta square. From that also you can you'll obtain the same equation confirming that omega square is g by l, or omega is square root g l, square root g by l. So therefore simple pendulum also becomes a simple harmonic oscillator in a small angle limit. Let's take third example of simple harmonic oscillation, this time from electromagnetism, and the example under consideration is LC circuits. So let's take the picture shown over here. We have got a circuit on the left hand side, we have got an inductor, on the right hand side we have got a capacitor. It's connected, they are connected by a wire, and there's a switch S in between. Let's assume that the capacitor is fully charged in the beginning and there's no current flowing in the circuit. At that moment I close the switch S. What happens? As I close the switch S, we have a complete circuit, we have current starts to flow through this circuit, and as the current flows, there's a potential drop across the inductor given by minus LGI by dt. And after some time, as the capacitor discharges, di by dt maximizes, the inductor becomes fully charged and the capacitor becomes completely discharged. And after some time, as the di by dt changes sign, capacitor starts to charge again, capacitor becomes fully charged and there's no current through the circuit. And eventually this flips back, so there's an oscillation going on over here. The charge in the capacitor oscillates. If there's a plus Q over here and minus Q over here, after some time the charge on the capacitor plates will flip, and the current in the inductor will also, direction of the current in the inductor will also change. There's an oscillation going on between, the potential is transferring from capacitor onto the inductor and from inductor back to the capacitor. So in this problem we'll explore exactly that. In terms of equations, we can use the Kirchhoff's law and write down the equation for the circuit. Using the fact that the total potential in the LC circuit is 0, we have the potential drop across the inductor, that is LDI by dt, plus Q by C, that is the potential drop across the capacitor, must add up to 0. Therefore LDI by dt plus Q by C is equal to 0. Now using the fact that current I is dq by dt, current I is dq by dt, I can replace this I with dq by dt, I get this equation L d to q by dt square plus q by c equal to 0. Now you immediately see that This becomes a simple equation of simple harmonic oscillator where Q is a dynamical parameter if I divide this entire equation by L. Dividing this entire equation by L, I bring the equation to this form where my dynamical parameter Q double dot plus 1 over LC times Q is 0. So charge is what becomes a dynamical quantity and it is the charge that is oscillating. Remember this charge Q was the charge we took on the capacitor. The charge was the charge that we took on the capacitor. So we find that the capacitor charge is oscillating. But because capacitor charge is oscillating and current is dq by dt, we will see that the current will also oscillate. So let's go ahead and work this out. So since 1 over LC is omega square, we get the result that omega is 1 over square root of 1 over LC. Let's go ahead and analyze the system from the view of the potential. For this system, you can work out the potential by simply adding the potential for the capacitor and potential for the inductor. The potential across the capacitor is 1 half q square by c for the capacitor, and for the inductor is a half li square. So this is my total potential q square by 2c plus 1 half li square, and if I do minus dv by dq, you can verify that you will reproduce this equation back. Therefore, potential formulation also helps in this case. So these three were examples of simple harmonic oscillations. We looked at a spring mass system, we looked at simple pendulum in the small angle limit, and we looked at the LC circuit. So we see that the simple harmonic oscillation appears in many diverse examples from various areas of physics, even in quantum mechanics, classical mechanics, electrodynamics. In almost every field of physics that you see, you will come back again and again at simple harmonic oscillation. So let's go ahead and look at now a boundary value problem for the LC circuits. So far we were just discussing example in general, but let's now go ahead and solve a specific problem, a specific boundary value problem, so that we can work out the constants. So let's go ahead and think of our LC circuit that the capacitor having a charge Q0 at time t equal to 0 as shown over here. So let's assume that our capacitor was fully charged at time t equal to 0, which is when the switch is turned on. Now let's find the charge across the capacitor as a function of time and current in the circuit as a function of time. Then show that the charge and the current have a phase separation of pi by 2, that is they are out of phase. Two oscillations are in phase when they are oscillating together, but here what is going to happen is that the charge and the current are not going to oscillate together. Charge will peak at a different time and current will peak at a different time. As a consequence, there is going to be a phase shift between charge and current, and we have to work out that phase shift or phase separation is pi by 2. Plot the charge and current on the same plot to demonstrate the phase shift. So let's go ahead and execute this problem again taking our computational thinking approach. So let's first look at the solution. The equation of motion is q double dot plus 1 by LC times q equal to 0. Solution of that is straightforward. Is qt equal to a cos omega t plus phi. Now we have to find out what is a and phi. This is the solution of this equation, but that does not tell me what is a and phi. In order to find out a and phi, I need the boundary conditions, and in this case boundary conditions are given to me. Looking at the boundary conditions, at t equal to 0 my current is q0 and switch is just turned on, so therefore my charge is q0 in the capacitor. And since switch is just turned on, there is no current flowing through the circuit. Therefore, I can say that charge in the capacitor at t equal to 0 is q0 and current in the circuit at t equal to 0 is 0. So these are my initial conditions. Current is dq by dt at t equal to 0. So these are my initial conditions given to me using, and the solution is q of t equal to a cosine of omega t plus phi. I have to find out what is a and phi. So let me use the conditions here. Using the first condition over here, I get, so from 1 I get q naught, that is charge at t equal to 0 is a cosine of omega times 0 plus phi. I have substituted t equal to 0, therefore I get this equal to A cosine phi. So A cosine phi must be equal to Q0. That's first equation for me. Second equation gives me dq by dt, that is current at t equal to 0. So dq by dt, current is 0, but dq by dt from here I get is A omega, and derivative of cosine is minus sine, so minus sine omega t plus phi. And this is 0, therefore from this at t equal to 0, so this I have to evaluate at t equal to 0, so I get this equal to minus A omega sine phi. Now I obviously cannot have A equal to 0, because taking A equal to 0 I get the trivial solution Q equal to 0, so I must have from the second equation sine phi equal to 0. Sine phi equal to 0 means phi equal to 0, and therefore my solution is simply Q of t equal to cosine phi becomes pi by 2. As I substitute phi equal to 0, it becomes cosine phi is 1, so this becomes A. So A Q naught is equal to A, this is Q naught, and I get my solution as A t is equal to Q naught cosine of omega t. Now that's my charge, and I can work out dq by dt also. Now that I know charge is a function of time, I can work out current as a function of time, and taking the derivative I get Q naught minus Q naught omega sine omega t. At this point I can go ahead and write down sine omega t, also I can write down in terms of cosine omega t, and I can write this down as Q naught omega cosine of omega t minus pi by 2. You can work out that cosine of omega t minus pi by 2 is nothing but minus of sine omega t. Let's go ahead and verify this. So I've worked out these conditions for you on the blackboard. I got phi equal to 0 and A equal to Q naught, and that gave me Q of t equal to Q naught cosine omega t, and I of t equal to Q naught omega cosine of omega t minus pi by 2. So we see that from these two solutions, Q of t equal to Q naught cosine of omega t and I of t equal to Q naught omega cosine of omega t minus pi by 2, that these two solutions have a phase shift and current is lagging the charge by a phase of pi by 2. Let's go ahead and verify this by plotting over here. So here's my plot of Q by t over Q naught and I by t over Q naught omega. In order to do the plotting, I need to non-dimensionalize. And the way I do non-dimensionalization is I divide Q of t by Q naught. So cos cosine omega t is a dimensionless function. Qt over Q naught, Q has dimensions of charge, Q naught has dimensions of charge. So Qt over Q naught is dimensionless. So what I am plotting on the y axis over here is Qt over Q naught. Similarly for the charge, for the current, I am plotting I divided by Q naught omega, because Q naught omega has dimensions of current. Q naught is the natural scale for the charge present in the problem. Omega is the natural scale, or omega equal to 1 over square root LC is the natural scale for inverse of time present in the problem. So natural scale for current in the problem becomes Q naught omega. So I divide the current by Q naught omega, and that leaves me with cosine of omega t minus phi. And that's what I'm plotting over here. I'm plotting over here cosine of t and sine of t, and this plot gives me, I'm missing a minus sign over here, so let me put that minus sign. Now this is correct, and I should put current is minus of sine t, plot that, and there we go. So what we see is that the charge is given by the solid curve, or the dimensionless, the charge in the capacitor in dimensionless unit Qt by Q naught is given by this solid curve, and current is given by this dashed curve. We see that the charge is always leading the current, that is charge peaks first and current peaks later. Current reaches its maximum after the charge. This is because current, first there is no current, the charge is maximum. As the charge decreases to 0, that is when the current reaches its maximum, and so on. So this is how, by plotting the dimensionless quantities, dimensionless current and dimensionless charge in the same plot, we can find out the whether the current is leading or the charge is leading, and we can see the phase shift between the charge and the current. As a homework exercise, I want you to calculate and plot the energy in the capacitor and energy in the inductor as a function of time. Remember, the energy in the capacitor is Q square by 2C, and energy in the inductor is half Li square. So now you know the charge and the current, so you can work out what is the energy in the capacitor and the energy in the inductor, and you can plot both of them on the same plot. What is the average energy contained in the capacitor and the inductor per cycle? Now the oscillations are very, very fast, so you really cannot measure energy as a function of time. What you will really see, if you try to make energy measurement, you will see average energy per cycle when the frequencies are very high. That is, when the frequencies are few kilohertz, the oscillations are so fast that you will not be able to measure the energy as a function of time, but all you will see is average energy. So think about how to calculate the average energy in the capacitor and the inductor per cycle. So this was an example of a boundary value problem where we solved a particular, given particular boundary conditions or initial value conditions, we found the solution for the charge and the current in a LC circuit.